Seen that one in a long time, that DX. Beautiful stuff in the studio. Check it out, GU.
Back then, I was more of like a DJ, and I would always go to the parties, and when we was listening to tracks, we was listening to more like Larry Heard and them and stuff. They the ones like kind of inspired me and Glenn. So Glenn started doing tracks because, like, everybody in his family are, like, musicians. They play, you know, instruments and stuff. So we would see each other always at the parties and stuff. And then I would listen to his tracks and be like, man, these tracks he's making is, like, ahead of his time and everything. But I wasn't making tracks yet until, like, the late 80s when I started, like, had, a Yamaha, like, little drum machine, RX-7. That was really, like, my first drum machine. So I would like program that, and Glenn heard some of my tracks and he was like, man, you program pretty good. You know, we should get together. And then once we got together from there, that's when like history started being made because he started teaching me a lot of things, you know, with keyboards and stuff and how to enhance my sound and everything. And it just, man, it just took me to another level, man. Like, just like that, you know, so. Back then, it was just more about us going to the parties, listening to good music, and we was always waiting for the Lou Lewis track to bust out or the Larry Heard track to bust out. And then once you start getting into it, you wanted to start making your own tracks so you can affect the people like Larry Heard and affect people. And you keep this thing going as a family, a unit, you know, and everything. And I mean, I love Chicago because Chicago is the home, it's the hub of house music. And it still goes on. It still, you know, got good things going on and stuff, but it also changed too. And every other country and everybody else, they know where house music comes from and everything. And it's just one of them things where, like, I wish I can go back to this year, but I can't go back to this year because we're in this year, you know. But you take, you know, you take what you got this year and you try to make a big influence on the younger generation. But that's what it is, because if I stop doing music right now, I want to sit back and then look at how it is. Like, okay, I guess I did pretty good because I influenced people, because now you got people not only buying Boo Williams records, but they're trying to make tracks like this and, you know, and trying to enhance their sound and everything. So everything plays a really good part to how we express ourselves with this music. I mean, and I love it. Much as I used to always say, oh, I'm gonna stop producing, I'm gonna stop doing this, but somehow it's not in you to give it up. You just can't give it up because you're surrounded by music 24 hours. Even if I don't mess with my keyboard or whatever, I go in my room, DJ room, I got records. So that's inspiring enough for me to go in there and start making music. So you can't escape this. Once it's in you, it's in your blood. It's gonna keep pumping and you're gonna feed off it and you're gonna wanna create. So that's why I go to parties, and even when I come to different countries and I DJ, I listen to other DJs play it and everything. I might hear something, I'll be like, I gotta go. I can't wait till I get home. Because when I get home, I'm finna get on here and make some crazy stuff. And you know, after that, you manifest it into the public now. Hey, this is what I came up with. And this is really what Boo Williams is about, man. Just giving, you know, good service. We all want to give a good service at what we do. I'm not trying to be the better DJ, the better producer. I just love what I do, and I just want to pass this thing on, you know, because I don't know what I would be doing if I wasn't doing music. I never, like, really thought about it, and I'm just thinking of, like, how I was as a teenager. All I wanted to do was go to parties, and my mother would be like, oh, you got to be back home at this time and everything and stuff. But I just had to be at the parties, even though I was too young to go to some parties, but I had to be there. And then it ended up with this. Back then, to have one of these was just like having gold, you know, and like everybody couldn't have this machine and everybody couldn't afford it because every producer has to use whatever he has to the best of his ability. So to have one of these is really enhancing your production on your sound. To have a 909, because there's nothing like the 909, the kick, the hi-hats, the claps. It's like, even when you first get this, you don't even want to touch nothing else. You want to play with this thing for a while because it's amazing. And when you hear how it's really done, you can really get into it. And once you learn it, everything else just becomes like real beautiful to you. It's real good. But like seeing one now is good because like Glenn has one in his studio and 808, and he keeps up with the rolling stuff and everything. But I don't never really be touching it when I go in there. He'll like, man, I'm finna mess with the 909. I'm finna make some old school tracks or whatever. And I never be messing with it because I'm still like trying to learn what he's teaching me on the computer and everything, because I'm trying to catch up with time and everything, because I was scared to mess with the computer. And he said, think of it as you writing with the MP60 or 909. And then I learned it like maybe like when he first gave me Reasons 5. And I learned it like in a week. And I was like really scared to touch it because I'm like, I'm not going to be able to do this. But he like, man, just take your time. And then once I learned it, I got really kind of happy. And I started making tracks because at one period of time, I kind of slowed down making tracks because I just didn't really like the way things was going. But he's always been that motivation for me and always been there like in my corner like, man, you can do it, man. I believe in you, man. It's just me and you. That's why we got the Strictly Jazz unit. You know, it's like me and him. We, you know, been through some hard times and rough times, and we got a new album coming out, and it's kind of like the old Relief, Defender, Peacefrog stuff. We figured that we wanted to take it back to the roots, you know, because like now when you listen to, you know, Glenn's music, it's real musical and everything and stuff, because he's always trying to progress with time. And we just said, man, we need to go back and take it back to that year of 95, 97, that era. So that's what we did with this new album and everything. So he still pulls it out and still play with it. So now when I go home, I'm going to go in the studio and I'm going to be like, I'm just going to take this home for about a month or something and get back reacquainted with it and everything, you know. But actually, when I used to hear tracks, I would always hit a 909. But when I would hit a 909, I would try to listen to how people program it. Because, like, you can listen to a lot of producers and everything, and sometimes you can get tired of the 909 because everybody is doing the basic patterns. But if you get someone that really know how to program it or do this, it becomes a weapon, like an arsenal. I mean, just to have this, man, that means you got the best piece, I mean, of equipment you possibly could have. I mean, it's like no one really, you're not going to go in too many studios or know too many producers that has this. So this made a big part of like music. I mean, because I think from the early 90s all the way up until like 2000, this 909 was there. And I mean, every producer was using it. And then later on, everybody started going back to the live drums and everything. But like some people that's always been using the 909, they still use it. So it had like a big effect. I mean, it definitely had a big effect on me because I like the seriousness of it. I like the punch, because like when I make my music, I think about making driving tracks. You know, like, okay, I wonder if I do this, I want to see how the crowd reacts when I started off like this, but then when it get towards the middle of the track, I'm really pushing it and I'm doing these different changes and stuff. But this 909, you just working it. Knobs and everything, hi-hats swinging it, breakdowns, because we used to do a lot of shuffles in our tracks and everything, but the shuffles is just a buildup to let you know, here come a change. You know, like a drummer, when he plays, now here comes another change. Now the track is finna take you somewhere else now. So that's what we would do with like with the 909. Like people will say, man, we love you and Glenn tracks, but man, it's hard to blend them when y'all doing them shuffles and everything. But people don't see it like musically what we're doing, you know, and it's just like we're not trying to be exactly like everybody else. That's why I say whenever you got this machine right here, you have the right to assassinate it the way you want to, or make it play how you want it to play, you know, man. That's just over the course of time of like messing with it for so long. Like when I was making tracks, I wanted to have my own style, but melodically, I was just trying to basically create something that nobody else really would do. Because people know you by the signature of your sound. Like if you go to the store and you like listen to this, man, this sounds like a Boo Williams track. And you listen to it, you listen to how the rhythms and the melodies go, and then you see the fine print. Yeah, he did this track and everything. So I was just basically like trying to do, that's why I started doing different alias names, because I didn't want people to just be stuck on like, oh, this is all he does, like this type of music. So I started doing stuff under Moon Man, Willie Snickers, so I can do different stuff like disco sample stuff, or like doing like real deep tracks, just doing a lot of different type of tracks so people can look at you and like, yeah, he know how to do a lot of different styles of music. And that melodic sound like was just, that was just something we always had, because it come from like I said, Larry Heard. It was that Chicago rich sound, man. It's like you couldn't like make tracks without thinking in that process of like, man, I'm gonna create kind of like Lil Lewis, but I'm gonna put my spin on it, or I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do that. And that's how it came out. And like, I never really thought my tracks was good, honestly. I just did it for the love of it. And when it went out, I remember with Cashmere, first I did the Midnight Express EP, and he said, Boo, they want you over in London. They want you over at E-Works in Berlin. I'm like, yeah, right, you're playing. So he shows me a magazine with a picture of me, Boo Williams, Relief Records, new artist, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, get out of here. So he was like, man, they love your sound and everything. So once I start coming over here and I start seeing the reaction of people, I said, I got to keep this sound going, because this is what they're looking for in me. When you being an artist, it's all about progress. So I think sometimes you're trying to create a better sound as you go. And sometimes you forget about those original roots because you're trying to be, trying to create different sounds. And every time you produce a track, you don't want it to be the same. Sometimes you just like, man, I got to go back to where it all started. And that's the blueprint, where it started at, where it's like, when you get so far into doing stuff and then you start working with people, you forget about that, because now when you start listening to everybody else's music, you're seeing that they're trying to do that sound and they can't do it properly. So you're like, I got to go back and show them how it's really done. And you go back and you do it and you feel like you back again, because you feel like you missed this one part of yourself, and you like went back to the roots of this, and you still created the same thing because you still had it in you to do it, you know. So like now, as far as producing, I was always trying to be a little bit more musical in my tracks. But then I kind of like felt as though like, this is what I'm good at. The Boo Williams that people know from back then. So that's why I've been sticking back to that now, you know, more so than trying to be too musical or whatever, because that's not really me. But I can, you know, get a little musical or whatever, and that's because I've been hanging around Glenn so long. But like Boo Williams, strictly driving tracks. I mean, like, I want the tracks, whereas when they play it on the system, it's beating so hard and people just losing it and going crazy. And then they're like, man, who made this track? Man, that's a Boo Williams track. Oh, I have to go to the store and get this the next day or whatever. So I want to keep just putting out good stuff and being consistent with my sound, but changing my sound, but not changing it so much where it'll have people wondering like, man, I wonder why you do that. You know, so progress, but still going back to the roots at the same time, you know. So that's where I'm at right now with my music. See, the good thing about the new generation of kids, like I made a track called Mortal Trance. I made this track like in 1997. So it got real popular again. So people was like, oh, man, I like the new track you did, Mortal Trance. And I'm like, I made that track like about 20 years ago. But it resurfaced and it lets me know that the newer kids, when they bought that track to them, they thought it was new. But it stood the test of times. But yet and still, it made me think like, wow, this is what they really into? Or this is what they're trying to create, because this is that sound that everybody loves. And so now I have to keep a close mind and a close watch on what I'm doing when I'm doing music now. Because this is influencing a generation of new kids right now, and this sound is what they're looking for. And every time they come up to me, I kid you not, mostly everywhere I go, they're always talking about Mortal Trance. And I made the track like in about 5 minutes. It wasn't like a track that I was trying to make to be big or anything. Even when it first came out on the original label, Residual Records, small label out of Columbus, Ohio, he hears the track, man, I want this track. I'm like, you want this? I was just messing around and it ended up being big. But that's how it is when it comes to music. You put your best tracks out there and people are like, oh, it's okay. But then the stuff that you don't really put nothing effort into, that's the tracks they want. So sometimes it can be depressing, but then sometimes it can be good. But in that instance, Mortal Trance resurfaced and did so good that it started getting me to come back over and tour again. The raw sound is just authentic. It's just dirty, grimy. It's like, it's just pure how you make it, because back then you didn't have a lot of technology where you could make music where it sounds good now because of digital. We was doing analog stuff and everything. So sometimes when you hear a track, it's raw, but then you hear that hiss in it. So we would try to hit Dolby to take it out, but we was like, no, just let it play like that, because it's just raw like that and it's underground. And that was always a thing with Chicago. Like, we always would say underground because we felt our music was so deep that it was under the ground. You know, so just to have that, it's just a raw sound. Everything was just raw to me because that's how we made it. It was like a prototype. You know, you always heard the prototype before you actually heard the finished track, because you might make a track and it's not even all the way done. So you get in the raw version of it. You know, like, compared to you hear it the next time, oh man, that one doesn't sound like that version. Well, you got the raw prototype and that's the first copy. The one you got over here is the one that's actually done together and everything. And that's why it was good to have different versions of these tracks, because that's what made that raw sound what it is. When it comes to Chicago, we have a handful of DJs that we have a handful of artists that still keep that original sound, but they're not really noticed like they should be, because you have a different sound now, because everything is commercial to me now. You know, you got EDM. You know, it's electronic dance music that's just taken over, and it's not really pure house music, but everybody think that's the sound now, whereas you got some of the original DJs and they're still trying, but their music is not sitting out in the top only to a handful of people. And when you go to these parties, you're not really hearing those tracks that you used to hear, because everybody now is on this new stuff, you know, the commercial stuff, and they think that is what's the sound now. They think that's what's relevant. And so we struggle a little bit, but only a handful of us, we still support each other. No matter how hard it is out there, we still believe that one day it's gonna convert back to how it originally was. because it always does that after so many years. Notice how something comes and it's not good. And then after a while, it starts fading out. And the original sound is, that's what it does like for Chicago. I don't know if it do it for everywhere else, but after a while, the people start really listening and they start getting tired of it. They like, well, okay, I'm like kind of tired of this. And then they start coming back to that original sound. And then now, if you're still doing it and you're still sticking to it, you become relevant again. You know, so I think what it is was like, I just like stayed in the trenches. When it got good, I was there. Then when it started getting bad, I still was there, but wasn't getting much work as I was. But now I'm getting work again because I'm staying with it. You know, instead of just like really giving up and saying, man, I can't compete with this commercial stuff. I'm not trying to compete with the commercial stuff. I'm just trying to be who I am and give people a really good service of music. But like, I'm just disappointed with the music, how it's involved now, because I watched the transition from how it went to this, to this. And people like say, oh, he's, you know, he's acting crazy or whatever. He shouldn't be speaking like that, whatever. But the truth is just the truth. Everybody see that, whether you're from Germany, London, whether you're from the States, everybody's seeing this transition of this music. And it's also the new generation of kids do not take the time to study the history of where the music comes from. They're just trying to create their own sound and just grow with it. Instead of going back like, okay, I want to actually see and understand where this original sound come from and go back and do your homework. That's what we used to do. We used to like, when we was listening back then, that's how we found out what was going on, because we played respect to the people that made the way for us to come. And I think they don't do that nowadays. It's just more of like, we're going to create our own style and we're just going to keep it like that. And we're going to have our circle. We're going to have our clique and nobody can't get in. So now they're making everybody else suffer because it's like a shell, a force field. You can't get in this force field unless you become part of what we're doing. And that sucks. So only way that that's going to change is the good artists, the good producers, just stick together and keep at it. Because when you got like a little crowd of people, if you keep on, you're going to keep building more and more and more. And it's going to be a demand like, we want this. We want this sound back and everything. So I get frustrated with it all the time, but I still try to keep focused because I know that deep down, it's going to revert back. It's going to convert back eventually. It's just everything is in due time. That's how it works. I mean, that's what time can be with you or it can be against you.